I'm Lane. I work for a company called Justin. I'm going to talk today about sharing legal user bases between different sites. So let's cover what the problem is. A website that allows user edits but needs those users to be of certain classes of people, like law students, faculty, lawyers, law librarians. You know, if you need to make sure that your users are these type of people, you know, how do you do that? So for example here, we have the WEX legal dictionary from Cornell. They want legal experts to be able to add or edit WEX entries. So how can Cornell make sure that only legal experts are able to edit? Well, they can do only pre-registration by administrator, which seems to be what they're doing right now. They have people to email them, and then they will create the user for them. So that requires requires virtually administrator to know who all the users are in advance, and requires a lot of time. You can require approval for registration, let people register, and then have to go through some sort of approval process. This also still requires a lot of administrator time because your administrator has to go through and validate that these people are who they say they are. And it's not so ideally that, this thing just kind of hangs here. They could just let everyone in and hope that only legal professionals care enough to sign up, but that's probably not very likely. You'll quickly get spammers or people who think that they know the law. Or you can give up, go back to option two because you don't have a better option, and go to the bar and wish for a better tomorrow. All right, so what's the solution? Well, what you need is an external authentication using a service that does authenticate that these users are who they say they are. And I'm going to mention two such services for the legal space right now. One is JustEA's Legal Services and Lawyers Directory, where we go through the process of making sure that all of our profiles are actually lawyers and that they've claimed and verified that they are who they say they are. And CALI, who has a great big database of law school faculty, students, and graduates, and the like. So how do we let your website, or Rex in this case, authenticate against one of these two services? And the easy answer is OpenID. OpenID is a open standard. What it does is that it allows users of one site to register or log on to another site without passing passwords between them. So it requires no loss of security there or anything like that, or sharing of access credentials. And it has the capability using the OpenID AX extension to carry pre-authenticated information with it. This is things like, in our case, what type of user are they? Because we have multiple types of users. The OpenID AX will just say, this user is a lawyer, this user is a law librarian. All right, so let's go quickly show how it works. So this would be the login form on CALI's WEX. And what we're going to do is we're going to add a couple of buttons to the bottom of this form, or they tell me they're going to move it to the top. But and we'll basically have a button that says sign in with CALI, and then another button that says sign in with JustEA, which you can't really see on that screen. It's very fuzzy. All right, so what will happen is if the user clicks on the sign in with JustEA button, then they will be taken to a login form on JustEA's account site, which is our login page, that says you are choosing to log in to law.cornell.edu using either OpenID or JustEA. If you'd like to continue, please log in below. Your password will not be shared with law.cornell.edu. So they enter in their username and password. And step three is, quite simply, they're logged in. OpenID takes care of all the stuff in the background. WEX will know at that point what type of user it is from Destia. Law librarian, professor, law student, or other. And they can grant different privileges accordingly. So if they say, I want lawyers to be able to edit anything, then they can let lawyers edit anything. Justy does all the work to verify people's identities. It's all done in advance before they even get there. And CALI also has a OpenID provider, which Eleanor will show off in a little bit. And it has a great database of law school faculty, students, and graduates as well. So what will accessing these other services and accessing the legal user base cost you if you want to set up a server, if you want to access these services? Well, it's an open standard, it's open source, it really should be free. Justia is with several other organizations sponsoring here at this conference, so call ourselves the Coalition of Free, or what is it, Coalition?
Free Law Coalition.
Yeah. And, you know, this is, we're members of, you know, there's various organizations out there now and growing that believes that access to the law should be free. And because, you know, people like the LII are trying to create this great big legal dictionary and encyclopedia, and they need to make sure that it's accurate, well, they're putting that service out for free. These services are going to be out for free, too. That's the way it should be. So, if you want to be able to authenticate against just the ID, we'll be putting up the plugin to access it up on a new site that we'll be launching up tonight, open.justy.com. There'll be free just the ID and CALI ID login plugins available for Drupal. And we've got some coming soon for movable type or WordPress.
But you know, I could use the WordPress one.
No, I'll put you there too.
I mean, for myself. Yeah. Because I've got the government. Mm-hmm. Actually, I don't want to authenticate.
But you don't actually even need a plugin in order to authenticate against the OpenID servers on Justy or CALI. It's an open standard server. So.
Oh, you do on CALI.
Oh, do you?
Because, my OpenID isn't that open.
Okay, I rephrase that.
And I'll talk about that.
Well, at least on Justy is, if you have any OpenID plugin can go and let you sign in, it just won't pass the extra information, like what type of person they are, or just let them log in. Oops, I thought that wasn't up there. Blogger, TypePad, WordPress.com, many other sites all support OpenID natively. So just have that little OpenID box, just type in accounts.justy.com, you'll be able to log in. And if, let's say, you have a user base that you've authenticated and you want to share it out with the world too, you actually can do this as well. Becoming an OpenID provider is not very hard. If you're using Drupal like we are, you can go to drupal.org/project/OpenID provider and download that module. It's not anything to do with us, we didn't write it, but basically, it's got only one setting. You install it, and you activate the setting, and then you're an OpenID provider. If you're a developer, you could actually extend it using a Drupal hook that will let you pass the additional information like we did. All right, just a quick wrap up here, and then I'll show a brief demo of how the login works. All right, you can find out more about Justy and the stuff that we do at justy.com. Our new Open Resource Center will be up at open.justy.com. Specifically, the Justy ID module will be on open.justy.com/justyid. Sure to follow and fan us on Twitter. Follow us at username Justia, and on Facebook, we're at facebook.com/justia. And while you're at it, you can follow me. I'm at my blog's at nick.pro, or you can follow me on Twitter at nickmulley. So that's it. I'm going to try to do a quick demo here and show you just how easy it is to log in using just the ID. So I'm going to turn here and vote on and see if that helps. All right, so over here, this is my blog. I've installed the Just the ID module just for testing it over here. So you can see I've got a sign in with Just the ID button sitting here on the, in my next to my login form. And if I do this, I'll be taken over to get the license ready. There we go. Take it over to the account's login page. So let's say you're choosing to log into www.nick.pro using OpenID. So I will log in using my Just the ID login. Hit log in, and I will be taken back to nick.pro. It says access denied. Oh, because it took me back to Just the ID, so it's not. All right, so there you are. You can see I'm now logged in. It's just ES/CAP. I'm looked up though, and I can actually now comment, and my comments will actually be attached to my Just ES login credential. So that's it. Do you want to do questions, or do you want me to pass it over to you when you do
it? I'll just do questions first.
Anybody have any questions? Went through it really, really fast. Supposed to have an hour. It's 12 minutes in. I swear I practice this longer.
Yeah, it's always longer.
Yeah. Nobody? Okay.
So is it really just same session variables? I mean, I know you did it through Drupal, but if you were going through Drupal and using PHP, could you just grab the session value? I'm just trying to compare it to using Shibboleth, which is what we're using for some of our stuff right now for authentication. And then once you get in, is there an Apache configuration changes for things?
There's no real Apache configuration changes because everything happens through HTTP requests.
Okay.
It works with a, it's actually done almost entirely client-side except for the actual authentication part of it.
Okay.
Much like OAuth, a token is created and you are passed with the URL with that token.
Okay.
Over to the login form. If you're already logged in, it just passes you right back with a new token. But the way it works there is that they, on the other side, it generates a new token, and it basically just generates a form that is submitted with JavaScript on by the browser that sends it back with all the posts. And there's a token, so then your server side also does a HTTP post over to back to the OpenID provider site with that token to validate that the information wasn't faked.
Okay.
And that's it. That's all there is. It's a very simple protocol. A lot of other people are using it. Google's OpenID providers, Yahoo's an OpenID provider. Facebook will be soon. Their Facebook Connect currently does not use OpenID, but they are switching to it, which is kind of cool.
Yeah, in comparison to Shibboleth, it's less complicated than that. In that it doesn't it doesn't require sort of the kind of dedicated server and there's no because Shibboleth and the stuff that's developed around that is really a lot more concerned about security. And this is not well. It's not concerned about security. It's not. I mean, the OpenID stuff is really not. Your bank's not going to use OpenID. Let's just put it that way. I don't think.
Certainly we have applications that we would want a lot of security, and there's nothing we just don't really care.
Yeah.
We just want to know if they're part of the law school.
Right.
And we're already using Pemaduke. We're already using LDAP. We're already using Shibboleth.
Yeah.
And I really don't see a problem with using one more at this point.
Yeah, and actually this'll fit on top of, like, for example, if you're using Drupal, with Drupal, you know, you can sort of, you know, tie this in with LDAP. And there's actually Drupal. I've actually looked at Shibboleth and the single sign-on stuff that goes with that, because there's Drupal modules that support it. But they just had like a level of complexity that just isn't, you know, that I just didn't feel like I needed in the sort of environment that I was operating in terms of OpenID. And that's just one of those things.
I'm not familiar with some of the ones you've got involved.
That's because it's strictly, what did it come out of, Yale or someplace like that? Yeah, it's an academic exercise in single sign-on across multi-systems in a secure Java environment or something like that. So it's, yeah, it's not for the weak of heart. since we have a ton of time to go, I don't have a ton of stuff prepared. Actually, if I can borrow your cable, because I lost my VGA thing.
Sure.
I think that works. I can just show you a couple of. I'm not going to actually have anything to say so much as perhaps rant on about OpenID. That should be it. When I mentioned that our OpenID isn't as open as
I should have gone over my presentation with him in advance.
Man, just like to make it up as we go along anyway.
Oh, is my aspect ratio all messed up like that?
I don't think yours was better. This one is. I'm just going to get all the way to one side. That's what I get for spinning around and looking at it backwards. That's what I was trying to do. Okay. That is off one side, isn't it? The CALI, the thing with OpenID is that it's open. And at CALI, we support open things. But we do need to know that law students, at the very least, are coming from the law school that they say they're from. Primarily because, I don't know if anybody knows this, but in the lessons, there's actually stuff that you license that we can only make available to students and faculty at member schools. So we have to have some kind of security that says, you know, we're pretty sure this is who this person is. And that's where those pesky authorization codes, people are nodding their heads going, oh yeah. Yeah, that's where the pesky authorization codes come from, right? They actually tie a student or a faculty member to a particular institution. That's sort of the best thing we have right now for doing that, by the way. Although some of the stuff that has come out of this, because Nick shared his code and I worked it over, and I have some ideas. Is anybody here anybody from any law schools here that are running Drupal for their students at all? One, two, cool, three. because one of the things that's possible with this, see, the way that this is set up is this lets you, this basically lets you, one of the things about OpenID is that if you enable OpenID on your site, like if I turn on OpenID for authentication on my Drupal site, anybody with any OpenID can log on to my site. Oh, I don't like that. But I do want to let some people from some sites log on. Right, because that's useful. And that's where this module actually comes in. Because you can actually, this module can actually be tailored. That's why it says, log in with your CALI ID, right? So I could give it to you and say, log in with your Stanford credentials to the CALI site. And then that way, if they have an account on your Drupal site and they log in, you can verify that they're coming from there and then they don't need that authorization code. See? Yes, it's all part of Elmer's secret plan to make the entire world use Drupal. That's right. If you're, yeah, thanks.
That was for that others.
Hi, Mom. Yeah. The but the thing is that with you know, this is actually something that we could work on with Drupal sites, you know, in terms of registering SKUs. Because what this does is this lets you essentially, it's more like having, like, instead of OpenID, I like to think of it as partner ID, right? So you can actually know who the party sending you the credentials is in the first place, so that you don't have just random people, you know, registering on your site. Then you've got to clean all that up later, which is kind of a drag, especially when when you're like a tiny shop like me. In case anybody's concerned about, you know, sort of the way that the CALI ID works, and just to reinforce the point, none of the information that, we're not providing any information to anybody. It's totally on sort of the student or the faculty members. They have to do it. And then a minimal amount of information gets sent to the partner site in order to sort of verify who they are. So like, for example, on the on Technoids, the site that nobody looks at anymore. Actually, let me know.
Some of here.
Yeah, like the three people that actually look at the slide. Okay, so we have a login using CALI ID button there, and when you click on that, just like happened with Nick's demo, it takes you to this CALI. This is our development site, and then I can log in here. Okay, so. Now this is going to authenticate me against my, the CALI database, and it's going to send, using that token stuff, it's going to send some of that credentialing information back to Technoids, and then Technoids either create me an account, or I've already been here, so it actually just logs me in, and now I'm logged in on Technoids as CALI.emaster, so it recognizes who I am. Now the thing about it is that if I come back later, because what happens is on our site then, the site is actually sending the credentials out. It remembers that I made that I did that. And then, so when I go to do it again, it'll actually ask me if I still want to do that. So I can, well, it helps if you don't click, if you click on the right button. Right, I haven't installed, Nick has those fancy buttons. He did one for CALI, which is cool, but I haven't gotten any patched into the software yet. No, it's just logging in right in. Oh, because I was already logged in on the other site. Yeah. So what this does is it opens up the possibility for, you could run the module. Logging with my local ID, and then that way your students wouldn't need to use the authorization code, because they would already have an account at your law school, and you could use, and they could essentially use that to log in. Now we could do the same thing with Civil and about a room full of Java programmers. The thing is a lot of those other systems that I've looked at are actually a lot more complicated getting the data from one institution to another. So that those sort of cross-institutional things don't work quite so well. This is actually about the best, short of tinkering with cookies, which you can also do, which is a little bit more, right? Because you notice how, like, if you're logged into Facebook and you go to CNN, it tells you what your friends are looking at and see how they're doing, and, I tried to figure out how to do that, how they're doing that. And the only thing I can think of is they've got to be, they've got to be looking at the Facebook cookie.
Yeah.
Because that's the only way. Yeah, exactly.
It's an iframe. It's an iframe. Facebook, so they're going to access
that. Yeah, so they can access that. And so they're doing stuff that just frankly, I don't want to do. I don't think it's a good idea. And I find it kind of creepy. I find myself logging out of Facebook a lot more.
It's important to know that CNN does not know who you are on Facebook. Even though it shows you what your friends are doing, it doesn't actually know what your friends are doing or who you are.
Exactly. Yeah, but it's still kind of creepy. I don't like it. I didn't like it when my Blockbuster queue turned up on Facebook that one fateful day when they turned down whatever Facebook was doing with that first time that they tried this sort of thing. Yeah, Beacon, that was it, yeah. And like all of a sudden, like my Blockbuster stuff is in my Facebook profile. I was like, hey, wait a minute. Not that, a whole mess of science fiction movies. Well, a whole mess of Facebook, or a whole mess of science fiction movies and stuff. I mean, nothing. But it's not anything I particularly cared to share with anybody, But there it was. Boom. So I want to get into that whole space. So, the idea of being able to say, we can accept credentials from a specific partner to log into our site, I think is very appealing to me, and this accomplishes that.
But what about the other way around? Do you restrict who can sign in using your CALI credentials?
You mean like going the other way? Like who gets the...
I wanted to set up a website.
Right, because what I was...
Can you stop me from doing
that? Because
there are a lot of tinkering to the OpenID provider module, the blocked site, or to only have
Well, the thing is that I actually have the OpenID provider running on that other one, and I have managed it. Now I'm running the software you gave me on the other side, and it doesn't run a totally open OpenID.
The server does. I mean, anybody can authenticate against it.
Using their CALI credentials to go someplace else.
Right.
Right.
But unless they have the version that passes the OpenID AX stuff, it won't pass any additional information.
Right. Yeah, the other way around, in other words, somebody being able to log into his site with credentials from our...
Right, that's what I was talking about when I said that anybody can sign in using OpenID.
Right.
Like, you can right now, you can go to Blogger, if you've got the server running, you can go to the OpenID provider running on CALI, you can go to Blogger, somebody's blog, and when you go to comment, it's that there's a bunch of options, one of them's OpenID. You can put in CALI.org there. Take you over to CALI, you sign into CALI, and pass you back and be signed in. That's the slide, what I was saying on the slide. I wasn't saying that the other way worked.
but the other way can work too, right? Yeah. If I'm accepting, I can get in.
Right.
But using this stops me, allows me to use
specific. Right, and that was the whole point of the Just ID module too.
The other way, for
example, they don't want to use any OpenID provider to sign in. They want specific ones.
Right. Yeah. Exactly. Right. Well, that's right. That's what I want to do too.
Right. You want to do it from law school, so it makes a lot of sense.
Right. Exactly. So I want to do it from specific law school.
And it doesn't even technically require Drupal. There are OpenID provider modules for a number of CMSs.
Yeah.
I know Joomla has one. Plone has one.
Yeah. And
like that Python plug stuff.
Right. And what I've always done in the past when I've had stuff talk to each other was just like use the databases. Like on my WordPress multi-user network actually just uses the user tables from Drupal.
Right. We've done the same.
Yeah, thing. And then that way, and then that lets you use the same account plug in on both sides.
Have you thought about even like on the CALI side, could get back any additional information? Like, if you'd be at Duke, and you could also send back whether the person was from Duke, and that might give them different permissions on your stuff that you're using.
We could do that. We haven't actually talked to any schools about Duke, because we just haven't been out of the time. But we could do that, because I've thought about that in terms of, one of the things, and, well, the camera's right, but Merrill never watched this, right? Nobody talks to John. One of the things I thought, well, because law schools, you know, law schools are getting pressure from the ABA to start looking at measuring outcomes, right? To do some, figure out a way to like sort of, you know, make sure students are actually learning the law. Well, CALI lessons are, of course, a really good way to do it. But the thing is that if you're a Duke, right, I mean, you want to be able to say, you know, not only does Duke as an institution need to know that, you know, we want our students to be able to run these lessons, then we want the information back, right? And, or we want to, we're gonna designate a certain group of students who can take certain lessons at certain times, right? So this would also provide a mechanism that would, you know, that could be used to trigger that sort of stuff. Then we'd need a little bit more security, though, because we're drifting into areas that are a lot more, you know, well, would require, you know, some higher levels of security. But I've been thinking about that sort of stuff in terms of being able to move specific students from specific schools into specific places based on information that the school provides. Yeah, because that's going to be a thing in the next couple of years. The equity readers, for anybody that was in the last session, it all depends on how much the ABA jerks around the curriculum standards as to how fast things will go to e-readers. Law schools might be a lot more, find themselves spending a lot more time doing work and trying to come up with, you know, ways to measure outputs than they will if they wanted to spend, you know, time and energy on e-reader stuff. So, who can say? Any more questions, comments, concerns?
The site that's asking for the login, the username's there. You're always appending the authenticating sign off. See, you had CALI. Is that normal, or is that just the way you have it set up?
No, if you thought it, so that you thought it was you, I need a login field on the site that you logged in from, with it. Because the home site would have, so like our site would have, we could log in with a Drupal credential digits to our site, or you could press either the CALI or the Just ID button and be taken to off site to CALI or Just ID and redirected back to our site.
When you come back, what's your username?
It creates a username based on the user. The way that we've got it set up in our demo is it's using the username from the originating site and it's appending the name of the site.
The reason to do that is to prevent
duplicate usernames of the guy that already come onto your site and registered with the same username.
Yeah, and actually I should have zeroed all this out and started over again because what happens is that at that initial, the first time it happens, it shows that you have to enter a password because it doesn't care. I think I've got some.
But if you had a username already, you could then go ahead and attach your OpenID one to that username. Yeah. You could come back in with the username originally. Yeah. Right. This one's just automatically allowing you almost like to create a new user, or if you didn't have one, that gives us one.
Yeah, that you can actually. I didn't show that in the demo because I have got to work on the UI of it a little bit, but. If you've already registered on the other site, there's a way where you can then attach the OpenID after you've logged in. And so that would then, from then on, you'd be able to use OpenID to log in. And it would attach the additional information. In our case, when the OpenID will pass in the type of person they are, which will then on the other site, you can actually pick, you have a bunch of drop downs, and it'll say, okay, this type of user gets this permission, this type of user gets this permission. And it'll also bring in the link to their profile so that you can link back.
Right, so the, I think this one will actually show the OpenID really well.
Yeah.
Right, so OpenID sites. Sorry about all that stuff at the top. Yeah, and again, the layout here is funky. But you can see that these are the places that I've logged in from. So you see Technoids is there. So I could actually turn that loose And now the next time, you know, if I now went back and tried to log into Technoids again, it would challenge me. You know, I'd have to, it wouldn't just do it automatically. Or I could turn that back on. Or something like that. Yeah, this is a little funny. On the Technoid side of stuff, let me just log on. This depends on the privileges.
Time's locked in, I see.
La 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 la. Okay. On this side, user management. There we go.
That seemed like the best place to put it, but not.
It is. This actually shows you some of what you can change. So that, like, for example, if you tried to use student credentials that were flagged as a student on the CALI site against Technoids right now, it would just get like the default like anonymous user credentials or whatever it is, and so you can't do anything. And then I created a separate, but if your FAC staff actually created a, those are actually, you know, I don't have a lot of roles on Technoids, but those are Drupal roles, so I can map those roles, you know, one to another. And so, and in that way, you know, you can figure out, you know, what you want to do with, you know, specific people. We're actually looking at this because of the way that we categorize people. We're actually looking at expanding this because we use organic groups for a lot of stuff instead of roles, for reasons that haven't come to fruition yet. But so you know, you have a role of student, but then that student's going to be in the class 2012 is an organic group, right? So if LII wanted to know about, you know, they only wanted third years to be able to edit on wax. So they would need to know two bits of information, right? They would need to know that they were a student, and then they'd also need to know that they were in the class of 2012 or whatever next year, 2011 next year. So we can pass them that information also. You know, and maybe they would say, well, we really don't want anybody from Duke, because. But then we'd probably say, well, you know, we don't think that's appropriate. But or maybe they would take the people from Duke and point them right at North Carolina, right? So, you know, here's the place to start. You can start with North Carolina law and, you know, and kind of go from there. You know, that this sort of mapping would allow them to do that kind of stuff on the back end of group. Yeah, I'll send you a bill. I just did, like literally.
Just this moment.
Just this moment. Never occurred to me before. But yeah, I mean, you could do that sort of stuff. Yeah, actually, you guys should be doing that.
I could go change my module. Yep.
Yes, that's about it.
On ours, because it's because you're authenticating against our fake directory, we also pass back the link over to their. In fact, one of the items on there was they're actually kind of ensuring this module that which co-brand domain is. That doesn't actually do anything in your version, but on ours we have directories. We have, you know, Jesse's version of the directory. Noel has a version of the directory. Oye has a version of the directory. So. We've got it where it'll put a link on their profile page. It'll put a link over to their profile on the other, to their profile on Jesse or Cornell or OAA.
Right. It's worth stating that what what between Justy and CALI, what they've been able to do is actually form a corpus of authenticated users that spans almost every legal professional in the country. From everybody that exists in the law school, from their larval stage of law students.
And a lot of them are larval, so.
up through taking the
Sorry, bar. Sorry, no offense.
Up through taking the bar and becoming admitted members of the bar. It pretty much covers almost everybody that you would want, every legal professional in the country. Not that we left anybody out.
Well, we've only got 70% of lawsuits, 75%. So there you go. Some of them just refuse to sign up.
Well, then they don't get to access WISE.
Well, that's the thing. Well, see, that's the other part. That's the other part for us, though, right? In sort of like what's in it for Tab, which is always a legitimate question. Perhaps the opportunity to write for WEX would be enough to get students to come to the site and sign up if they haven't already. We've talked about doing other things like. Letting students, display badges, we've got 60 some contracts lessons, right? So, maybe a badge that says, I've done 50 contracts lessons and I've scored, 95%, that sort of stuff, the gold star in contracts, and then if the student wanted to, they could use that credential to start editing contract stuff with WEX.
Right.
That's a sort of threshold.
Mm-hmm. It'll be left.
Well, that would be the thing, right? I mean, but right, that would be a decision you guys would make, and that would be like sort of a perk on this end for saying, here you go. And then that gateways them then to a whole bunch of different stuff, because then they can get to WEX, and then they're exposed to the legal directory for at Justy when they're out practicing and all that sort of stuff, and sort of fans out from there. I mean, right now the students come to our site and they run lessons, or they look at the shiny certificate if they got one of the excellent sort of future awards. Those are two things they do. I mean, they don't do a lot of other stuff because there's nothing else for them to do, which would be the thing. This is one of those things I think you can use that a little bit more. Is it design? I want awesome people's side. That's what
I mean. One of the important things for us is we're storing lots of different numbers attached to each profile as people contribute or participate. So I know we'll talk about this tomorrow, but if you do different things on WEX, we're gonna have like different values and numbers, and maybe there's an overall WEX value, maybe there's one if you're doing stuff on business pages, right? You're doing something on criminal law, so you can actually get a little bit more finely tuned. We got lots of bloggers that we're indexing for ourselves in the ABA. We can sort of flip through their blog posts, how frequent they blog, how we get some sort of idea of the quality of blogs based on backlinks that are coming in to other bloggers. So there's a lot of different measurements that we get by participation, and the feeling is if we give people credit for participating, right, and they get some sort of higher placement, some kind of more profile views or something, some more Google visibility, I guess, you probably might think of it, in different places, then they'll actually participate more and more and more. And that's sort of the goal. Get these guys to participate by giving them something for it. Because there's a lot of money right now being paid for marketing dollars by lawyers just to get different sort of places within Google. And this isn't just on the injury and criminal law side, but this is, class action defense blog, Michael Hassan's blog. He's an appellate litigator, Jeffrey Mangels. It's really good. The guy's all the bloggers, or at Lex blog, if you see some of the ones Kevin's done for some of the larger firms. They spend a lot of time trying to figure out how to participate. But all they want really is to sort of see themselves show up when they do Google searches on antitrust. And so if there's ways to not just have right about antitrust, but how they have their profile there participating and so some sort of added value. I think there's a lot of work these guys will do, which we, as a community, really don't take advantage of too much because they haven't been, they don't get credit for it, they don't do it at the end of the day. So that's sort of where we're going with it. And obviously with the CALI stuff, the same thing. People took more classes and tests. Then we start featuring, it's almost like an SSR thing. You're the top 10 contract guys
Although, you know, it's interesting. We would have some students who would never run lessons or never save their scores, which would be the thing, just because they don't want. I mean, you know, we give out those Excellence for the Future awards, and they're publicly displayable, and most of them are. Some schools opt to not show them, but like John get like an email a week from some student saying, "I want you to take mine off. I don't want it publicly displayed." And the few times when John's paying people about that, because sometimes he does, he gets responses like, "Well, I don't want, you know, if my classmates know that I, you know, got this award, then they're going to be bugging me for my outlines, and I don't like them." So, so that's a funny, like, sort of like flip side and stuff. But most people are like really excited, you know. I mean, those awards that we do, the links turn up on resumes, and actually linking to them is especially popular with Cornell grads.
Bravo people, they're always indexing.
Yeah, they're always doing that sort of stuff. Well, see, the key part here is that we wrap up a little bit early, because then we can get to the bar, which I believe is, I think it's an open bar. Although it doesn't open until 5, but it is about a 5-minute walk. And I think it's stopped raining. Does anybody else have any questions? Yes.
Yeah, where is the open bar?
Well, it's going to be. It's actually in the student center, which is going to be. It's across the quad. It's like directly opposite where the when you're heading down across the quad, the theater was on the right. It's on the left.
How grand is Congress? We wouldn't have to walk anywhere else today.
I'll tell you what, Dan. I'll call you up a golf cart. You just wait over there.
I see.
Yeah.
Next time, I'm going to bring our first station 6 times.
That'll be fine.
It's got the zany.
Yeah. I'll just take a look at that. Here it is.
All right. Yeah, I'll let
it. I saw that.
I did. Same lesson.
Really small. When the first round of emails get like half hour after the first session, they say, "Hey, your video's ready." Man, what are you going to do? Right now in the middle of August.
It keeps people looking.
It does.
It's when you know the video's going to start.
Yeah, you know it's going to start.
Yeah.
So you get to go around.
That's right. I like it. See
you. All right, this is important to pick up. Oh, yeah, I'll be, although I do have to drive back tonight, so I'll be.
it's control.
Thank you. is that sign on the door?
Do you think it might be upstairs today?
Oh,
really? Oh, it just feels like strange that nobody's here.
Everyone's gone from the hallway.
Thank you.
class would be in here? Do you know what the class is?